Hello, this is Jose Luis here at Parametric Camp, and welcome to another video in our series Crash Course to the BeeGraphy platform. I think that's going to be the name. So in this video, what I would like to do is I would like to do a hands-on exercise where we're going to try to model the Berlin Holocaust Memorial, which if you already know me from this channel, you like that, you know that it's a very good, it's an exercise that I really like as an introduction to parametric modeling. So the way we've done it in the BeeGraphy platform, the BeeGraphy editor, is by basically creating this parametric definition where we create a grid of points, we place rectangles, we extrude them, and we give them variable height based on some sines and cosines functions, okay? So you can see that everything is parametric, and that if I were to change any of the inputs, then the whole model will basically readapt to it, okay? As you can see right there. Beautiful. So if you want to learn how we did this, then just hang out in the video. Let's get right into it. Before we start, as with the previous exercise, I would like to remind you that we have done this exercise, the Berlin Holocaust Memorial exercise, in this channel previously. We've done it in a different modeling editor called Grasshopper. But if you want to learn more about the thinking process and the modeling process, you can go to this video. The link is going to be in the description of this video, and there will be a card popping up in the description as well. And in this video, I also explain the methodology of how we're going to create these boxes. However, I'm going to use a slightly different methodology in this video for the reasons that I will explain as soon as I start getting into the meat of the exercise. Okay, beautiful. So we're going to do just like we do with any model in BeeGraphy. I'm going to go to my dashboard. I'm already logged in with my account, and then I'm going to create a new model, and I'm going to call this Berlin Memorial Life, okay? And I'm going to create a new empty model. How am I going to start? Well, if you remember from the image that I showed before, the memorial is basically a collection of concrete blocks that have roughly the shape of a box. And what makes the monument interesting is that the height, they're all arrayed in this kind of grid-like manner, but the height of each one of the boxes is variable. It differs, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to start by creating a grid of points, roughly a rectangular grid of points, and then we're going to create blocks in each one of those points, right? We're going to create boxes. And once we have done that, then we will modify the algorithm so that the height of each one of those boxes is different based on some kind of rule. So let me get started with that then. So first of all, I'm going to create a grid of points, which I'm going to use as the basis for rectangles that I will extrude into boxes. How do I start creating a grid of points? So I don't know. Let's imagine I'm fairly new to the editor. I'm going to double click and say, I need something like a grid. Okay. All right. So I'm going to search grid, and it turns out that I have a rectangular grid. So that's pretty useful. And you can see that I already have here this kind of preview of the grid with the origin, width, length, how many elements in each one, etc., etc. So that's pretty nice. All right. So I'm going to start adding sliders here. So range input. So that's going to be what? Something from 0 to 100. And that's going to be the width. And I'm going to copy and paste this. And this is going to be the length. I'm going to make this very long, very long. So I'm going to make this larger. All right. Beautiful. And then something that I want to do as well is the amount of elements in each direction. For those, I want inputs that are integers. But the way I do that is by customizing the input to only snap to increments of one. So I'm going to say here that this slider is going to go from 0 to 50, all right? And I'm going to do 30 of these elements. And then here, I'm going to do another 30 in the Y direction. And you can see that I already have a lot of elements here. So I think I'm going to lower the count just for the sake of like having like a bit more responsive, faster modeling environment. So for example, 10 and 5, okay? Beautiful. Now, what you can see is that this particular rectangular grid gives me width, length, x count, and the padding. The padding is basically the gap between rectangles, and that it gives me both the center points and the curves. So the curves are going to be those rectangles that I can extrude, right? Now, we could go with this. We could just control the padding, right? And then if I were to control the padding, then basically I would be controlling how the distance between them. But I don't personally like that a lot, because the distance then has to be the same in both directions, x and y, and it feels like I have less control. So I kind of like better to, let's say, control the width and the height of each box independently, regardless of where they are, right? You can also notice that the moment I make the gap bigger, the entire grid also enlarges. So I could go for that, but and also for the sake of practicing things, I'm going to ignore the curves that are coming out of the component, and I'm just going to work with the points only, right? I'm going to use the points as the center of a collection of rectangles. So, for example, rectangle by center, okay? And I'm going to use the points as the origins, and then for width and height, I'm going to copy some range input. So this is going to be the width, which is going to be something like this. And this is going to be the length, all right? And then I'm going to get all these curves. I'm going to turn this off, okay? And you're going to see that now I have these tiny rectangles that I need to increase. And I think I probably need to make some of these smaller. Yes, exactly. I may need to increase this to 50. Okay, so 50, and then here 50 to, okay. So now I can increase this. Exactly. So now I have more, you see what I mean with this? I have more fine control over the size of each one of the boxes independently, okay? Which I kind of like better. I like control when I'm doing parametric modeling. All right, beautiful. So I now have a grid of rectangles, and I'm going to start moving things here to the left-hand side so that I have all my inputs right here. Something that we can do with the editor is we can group things. So for example, I'm going to create a group, and this is going to be called grid parameters. And I'm going to create another group here. I'm going to click on create group, and I'm going to double click and say this is going to be called box parameters. All right. And at some point I will add names here for what each thing is. Okay. But now, so I have rectangles in 2D, but I want boxes. So I'm going to want to extrude each one of these rectangles. So I'm going to go here, and is there any kind of extrude? Yes, there is extrude here. So I'm going to extrude the curve, for example, and I'm going to take all these rectangles, and the vector is going to be, I don't know what there's here by default, is a vector with 10 units, vertical 10 units, okay? I can work with that. So for example, let's say that I'm going to leave it like this, all right? Like a 10 or not. Actually, let me create a vector. Vector in the Z direction, and the factor is going to be what? It's going to be some kind of value from 0 to 50, okay? This is going to be temporary. And this is going to be just temporary. Okay, because what I want is, yes, just to start with a bunch of boxes that are all the same height. You can see that these boxes, though, are empty. So I'm only extruding the curve, and therefore I only have the shell, the boundary shell, if you will. So something that I would want to do is I would want to cap those surfaces and close them up. Okay, and then you see that the moment I do this, then now they are closed on the top and on the bottom. All right, beautiful. So therefore I can stop and hide these folks and then just keep the boxes that I have extruded. All right. Beautiful. Okay, this is looking great so far. Now, however, I'm going to need to extend this exercise to make something where the height of each one of the boxes is variable, all right, according to the design of the original monument. How are we going to do this? Well, it turns out that as of right now, the BeeGraphy editor doesn't have inputs for importing geometry. So in the previous video, in the other video that I pointed as reference, what we did was we modeled a surface and then we calculated the distance between the base of the rectangles and that model surface. In this editor, we can't do that right now. So what we're going to do is we're just going to come up with some kind of mathematical expression, like a sine and a cosine, and we're going to use that expression to calculate the height of the box based on where the box is in the X and Y spaces, okay? Beautiful, so how are we going to do that? Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take each one of the points that are at the base of the rectangles, and I'm going to deconstruct them, deconstruct point to extract their X and Y coordinates. You can see that by doing that, if I plug a panel here, you can see that what I have now is a collection of 50 X coordinates. So 0, 0, 31, blah, 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 whatever. And the same goes for Y, okay? So what am I going to do this for? So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to design an expression where given an X value and a Y value, I'm going to do some sines and cosines to calculate basically a wave in 2D for those values. So I'm going to go here to math expression, all right? And then I'm going to add here at port. So I'm going to add the X coordinate and the Y coordinate. And then what I'm going to do here is I'm going to say, I'm going to multiply the sine of X, okay, times the cosine of Y, all right? And this number is the number that I would use as the height for each one of the panels, each one of the boxes. So if I plug it here, you can see that I get a range of numbers, 2, 2, 2, 2, all right? And so let me now remove this static number and plug in here this, all right? However, the result is pretty disappointing for a couple of reasons. The reasons are that, first of all, I hit a bunch of zero values. So those are a bunch of rectangles that are basically no height. And because I'm working with sines and cosines, some values are positive, some values are negative, and most of the values are actually pretty, pretty small, basically in the range of -1 to +1, okay? So what we need to do is we need to massage these numbers a little bit so that we introduce some factors to amplify and correct these numbers so that the range of values is much closer to the actual dimensions of these boxes. So how can we do that? So I'm going to add a new port, okay? And I'm going to call, I'm going to call it Z, okay? I'm going to add another port that is going to be called I. The names of these ports are automatically generated by the system, okay? And how can I add another port? Yes, okay. So I'm going to say that C is going to be some kind of base height, all right? So I'm going to say this is going to be this slider from 0 to 50, and it's going to be C, and I'm just going to add here this base value. So any box is going to be this base height, so for example 20, plus whatever variation, all right? Now we can see that the variation is very small. Most numbers are in the 20 to 19 to 21 range. Still not a lot, okay? But at least we have solved the zero problem. What we can do now is basically we can amplify the values of X and Y by some factor. So for example, what I can do is I'm going to say that this is going to be the wave strength in the X direction. All right, and I'm going to say that I'm going to multiply this here, and I'm going to say that this is going to be that, and then I'm going to multiply this by the entire thing. What that is doing, it is actually in the Z. What that is doing is basically multiplying all these numbers here that oscillate between minus 1 and 1 by the value of 10. So then now the range of values is actually much larger. So you can see that we get numbers 23, 24, 17, 25. So the amplitude and the difference between these folds is much, much larger. Okay. And then something else that we can do is we can modulate these two values so that the sine, so that the waves have a different amplitude. So I'm just going to add here, for example, another couple of ranges. So range input, so something is not working right now. So let me see what's going on. Yes, so I'm just going to click here range, and I'm going to get a new input, and then this is going to go here too, and then this one is going to go here. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide x by j, and I'm going to divide y by k. All right, and in doing that, now what I can do is I can modulate, for example, this range, and you can see that the variability is going to be much larger. All right, so you see that we get this kind of effect of increased variability. I don't know how to pronounce that. All right, cool. Let's increase a few elements. Like, let's do 15 in this direction. Let's do 10 in this direction. No, 120, no. Okay, 120 is a lot. The app is going to take some time to recalculate. Okay. Give me 1 minute. Oh boy, look. Yes, so I'm going to do just 10. Exactly. And then, yeah, it's a much more feasible number. Okay. Beautiful. Okay. So I think we are pretty much done, aren't we? Well, I'm going to, for the sake of visualization, I'm going to add a material as we did in the other example. I'm going to add here some kind of color, and the color is going to be gray, just because I guess the original memorial is made of concrete. So we're going to make them a little grayish. All right. And I'm going to also hide the rectangles at the base. And I think that's probably a good place to end the exercise here. Okay. Beautiful. So we have something that resembles the Berlin Holocaust Memorial. And I think this has been a pretty good exercise in all also to see what kind of options we have with the BeeGraphy editors in terms of modeling. A grid of points, rectangles, extrusions, etc., etc. Okay. Now, again, as we said in the previous video, what now? So I have the model and I want to somehow download it and export it and 3D print it or render it in some other software. What do I do with this now? So that's exactly what I would like to address in the next video, where we're going to talk about how to export models in BeeGraphy and also how to connect them with one of the coolest features of the BeeGraphy platform, which is the market. Okay, so if you're interested in how to do that, come see us in the next video. And in the meantime, maybe like this video, subscribe to the channel, say hi on the comments, etc., etc. All right. Thank you very much and see you on the next video. Bye-bye.